Welcome back to Let's Code. I'm Chris Biscardi, and today we're going to talk about one of the new features in Rust 1.63, which is out now. Specifically, we're going to talk about scoped threads today. Now, we're going to use scoped threads as a vehicle to discuss some lifetimes, so let's dig in. I've pulled down the example code from the blog post that shows off what scoped threads are capable of doing. I'm going to run this as cargo run bin scoped, and I'm going to pipe that to complete because I'm using new shell, and complete will capture standard error and standard out for me. You can see the two binaries we have in the project right now are scoped and not scoped. Running scoped, we can see the output. Of course, we have the compilation. Then we have debug on standard error, which is a reference to A on line 9, which is 1, 2, 3. And then we have hello from the main thread, hello from the second scoped thread, hello from the first scoped thread. Now, for some reason, the standard out isn't in this box with the standard error as well, or the standard error rather isn't in the box with standard out. I think that's a new shell bug. I don't know why that isn't captured, but let's dig in. So we start off with let mute A equals a vec of 1, 2, 3 and let mute X equals 0. We open up a new scope and we spawn two threads and then we print out a new line. After the scope, we use the mutable access that we have to A and we push the number 4 into it, and we assert that x is equal to a.length. But we started off with x being 0, so how does x get to be 4? Well, in the first thread we've spawned, inside of this closure, we print out hello from the first scoped thread, and we print out a, or a reference to a, which gives us this debug output here that we saw earlier. The second scoped thread prints out another line, and because we've mutably borrowed here, we can set x equal to A0 and A2. So A0 is 1 and A2 is 3. So X plus equals 4 means that X will be 4. If you're used to using threads, this may seem a little bit odd because what's happening here is that standard thread scoped is creating a scope in which we can spawn new threads. Those threads are automatically being joined at the end of this scope. And when all of the threads have completed, then this entire block completes, and then we continue with our program. So that's what scoped threads allow us to do. It basically allows us to kick off some work, make sure that work has returned, pass references, whether mutable or not mutable, or shared, into the closures that our threads are using, and then continue our work afterwards. Now, if you're used to writing Rust, but you haven't written threaded code yet, this may seem pretty natural to you. So let's take a look at what it looks like if we remove the scope here, and instead of using s.spawn, we use standard thread spawn. So this is the version of threads that we had before that are not scoped. And you can see already that this isn't going to compile, but let's take a look at what the errors are. So cargo run bin not scoped, it'll try to compile, and then we get a bunch of errors. If we scroll all the way up, we can see closure may outlive the current function, but it borrows A, which is owned by the current function. In this case, it points to the closure itself. That's why it's pointing to the two pipes here. So closures here are like anonymous functions in other languages. They capture the variables that they're using from the outside. And it says that on line 9 in debug reference to A, we're sort of borrowing A. So what this is saying effectively is that the closure is going to live longer than A is potentially going to, because the closure doesn't have ownership over A, so it doesn't have any control over how long A lives. So what might happen in this setup is that this thread might spawn, this whole function may run, and then at the end of this function, we're going to drop A because this function no longer needs it. If that happens before this thread has finished, which can happen in this scenario with this version of threads, then we have a borked program, like it won't work. So that's why we see this note here. Function requires argument type to outlive static. This little tick means that this is a lifetime. So what we're saying here is that the function, the closure here, requires the arguments to outlive the static lifetime. And it gives us a little bit of help. It says, hey, we can force the closure to take ownership of A and anything else it references using the move keyword right here. So we could move like this. And of course, we would have to do that in both places. But then, of course, if we move it into the first closure, we can't move it into the second closure because we've already moved it into the first closure, right? So we've taken A. We've said, hey, move it into this thread. We've tried to start up a second thread concurrently, and we've also tried to move that into this thread. So we can't move a single value into two places at the same time. So this actually isn't going to work for us. So one answer here is that in this scenario, we could clone the value. So we could say, you know, let b equals a.clone, and we could pass in b here, and this could be move, and then it's fine. And then we still have an issue on the other one. So our first one is solved. We've solved it though by not quite what we may want to do. So we've solved it by cloning the data and then passing the new clone of the data through into this thread. And we keep the A outside of this. So we basically removed this from the equation entirely by duplicating this vec. But again, we run into another issue because even though in here we are accessing A and we're accessing it immutably, which means we can use a shared reference, we want to mutate it here, which means we need an exclusive reference. In the old threading model, these spawns can live potentially forever, right? Like we talked about earlier, for a lifetime of static. A lifetime of static means it could live until the end of the program. So if we need an exclusive access here, and we've already given away a shared access to somebody else, that causes us trouble. We can't do that. So we can do things like use arcs and other data structures, or we could use channels to do communication and message passing and stuff like that. But we have an easier solution now. We have scoped threads, and scoped threads allow us to pass these variables around. So now that we look at the scoped threads example, we are creating a scope. We're spawning the threads inside of that scope using the scope variable. The scope is automatically joining these together and making sure that they complete before we move on with our program, which means that any of the references that we pass in to each any of these threads are guaranteed to be done and over with by the time we want to take this exclusive reference and pass and push for onto the vec. Now, one thing I forgot to mention, I think, is that I wanted to mention in relation to lifetimes is when we decided to clone in not scoped and pass the new cloned value in, what we're doing is we're giving this thread ownership over that variable, which means that we don't need to rely on somebody else's control of it for how long it lives. We now control how long it lives. So that satisfies the static lifetime constraint because we own it, we being the thread in this case. So a static lifetime can mean this thing has to live potentially until the end of the rest of the program. Or if you give me control over this, if you give me ownership, then I get to decide when it drops out of scope. And thus we don't have a problem anyway, because now I have ownership and I get to decide when it drops. So it'll definitely be available for me because I will only drop it after I use it. So that's scoped threads and a little bit about lifetimes. And specifically, I really want to drive home the fact that a static lifetime roughly means lives until the end of the program, and ownership can often bypass that restriction, or not bypass it, but satisfy that restriction. So scoped threads allow us to pass references into these threads. But because we're using this scope and because this automatically joins the threads at the end of the block, that means that these threads are guaranteed to end before we continue with the rest of our program, which is really nice if that constraint works for you. So that's scoped threads. It's kind of cool. I like it. It's interesting, at least. If you don't write threaded code very much, then it won't really matter that much to you. But hopefully you got a little bit out of this in terms of the lifetimes that are involved and what it means to have a static lifetime. We'll have more videos on lifetimes in the future because they seem to be a topic that people like to ask about. So I'll see you in the next video and have a great day.